Thank you, Carolyn. Well, I'm sure that many of you are just like me, and that when you see a patient with neck pain on your schedule, you sort of cringe inside. Patients are oftentimes very difficult to treat. The diagnoses are vague. The treatments oftentimes are not effective. The patients want to know why they're hurt. The doctors can't really give them a good answer. So it can be a very frustrating condition. But what I want to do today is to just sort of go through some of the basics, some of the very basic things that we can identify, and at least sort of help establish a little bit of a framework on how to approach these patients. My disclosure is not relevant. So we're first of all going to talk about functional anatomy and how that might apply to some of the symptoms patients report, the pathology that affects the cervical spine. We'll go over the clinical evaluation, and then some case studies and just some syndromes or entities that everyone should be very comfortable in diagnosing, including myelopathy, radiculopathy, mechanical neck pain, cervicogenic headache, and cervical brachial syndrome. And then a live exam, which will be fairly brief, actually. So I'll first start out with functional anatomy. One sort of common misconception is the cervical spine is just like a little miniature lumbar spine. And it's really not. It's very different. In the thoracic and lumbar spine, the vertebral bodies are sort of blocks, and the discs are flat, and they're designed primarily for bearing load and not so much movement. So they move mainly by tilting against each other. The cervical spine is very difficult, different. It has to be very flexible because it's supporting the mission of the eyes, basically. It needs to turn the head around to look in different directions. And it doesn't bear much load. The weight of the head is around 10 pounds, so there's not a whole lot of load that's being placed on the discs and the vertebral bodies. So they're smaller, and they have a unique shape, which we'll look at again in just a second here. So the cervical vertebral bodies are characterized by these things called uncinate processes. They're over at the side of the vertebral body. It's a little sort of uplifting of bone there that articulates. It's not really a true articulation, but pseudo-articulation with the one above. And the importance of this configuration is that it really turns the joints of the cervical spine into a saddle joint, which is a very stable, very flexible type of joint. So it's very different from the joints in the lumbar spine. And just to point out, these areas where these uncinate processes are, because there's so much motion that occurs there, it's also a place where there's a lot of pathology developed. So that's a place where we'll see various types of things that we're going to discuss in just a couple minutes. Moving sort of laterally from the anterior vertebral bodies, we get into the neuroforamen. I think everyone's pretty familiar with those. That's where the nerves comes out. And then the facet joints are a little more posterior. Here they are from the side view. These are the facet joints here. They help guide the motion movement of the inner space. And this is what things look like in the rear view. So you see, the facet joints, these are the lamina of the vertebral segments, and then the facet joint is right underneath on the lateral aspect in what's called the lateral mass. So these are all things that are potential sources of pain. And of course, I'll just go back for a second. Of course, this is not showing the ligaments except this midline nuchal ligament, but there's a lot of ligaments that attach to these joints, a lot of tendons that attach with the muscles. So there's a lot of things in there that are potential sources of pain. One thing that's very important to recognize is that the very top of the cervical spine is highly specialized, and it's called the craniocervical junction. The atlas is basically just a ring of bone. It doesn't have the typical morphology of the other, what we call the subaxial vertebral bodies. It's basically just a ring of bone, and the importance of that is that there's two joints. One is what's called the atlanto-occipital joint. So the occipital condyles are sort of received into these surfaces here, and then there's the atlanto-axial joint, which connects the atlas to the axis, and the atlas rotates around the dens, which is right here. So the important thing about this is that roughly 50% of the rotation of your head takes place right here at the atlantoaxial joint. So if you have patients that have a very prominent component of pain with rotation, then oftentimes this is where the problem lies. The atlanto-occipital joints, honestly, I don't think are painful very often. That's more of a nodding movement is what activates those joints. But I honestly don't see too many patients that have that particular problem. The atlanto-axial joint arthritis is quite common. Then we get into the muscles. There's a lot of muscles. It sort of makes the shoulder look simple by comparison. This is the trapezius, everyone's familiar with. Once you take that off, there's lots of other muscles in here. And if you peeled these back some more, there'd be even more. There's multiple layers of muscles. And they have very complicated actions. They move the head in different directions. And they can be important sources of pain. These are the anterior muscles, the platysma, sternocleidomastoid. These, I don't think, become painful very often. Most pain that you have in the neck is posterior, and I think it's more related to the posterior muscles. It's fairly unusual you have a patient complain of anterior pain. So I don't think myofascial pain involving these muscles is that important. One thing that's really important to note is some of the lateral muscles here. These are the scalenes, middle and anterior, and they attach to the first rib and to the cervical transverse processes. And these, just like any other muscles in your neck, can get tense and go into a little bit of spasm, and we'll see what implications that can have in just a second. So what causes pain? So let's trace out the nerves. Anything that has a sensory nerve supply can cause pain, obviously. So if we start centrally at the spinal cord, you have two roots that come off, the dorsal root, which carries afferent information back to the spinal cord, and the ventral root, which sends motor information out. These nerves combine to form a mixed spinal nerve, and then they branch into what's called the dorsal ramus, and this innervates everything that's basically posterior to the transverse process. So all the muscles, skin, and so on in the back get innervated by this dorsal ramus, and including the facet joint. Then you have another branch of this nerve. It's called the sinovertebral nerve, and that comes out, and that sort of re-enters the spinal canal, and that innervates the dura, all the ligaments. So all the elements, most of the elements of the spinal canal are innervated and can be important sources of pain. And then you have what's called the ventral root, and that's what goes out and forms the cervical and brachial plexus. So this is just an illustration of how some of these nerves, the ventral rami, where they end up. The superficial cervical plexus is right here. Well, it's hidden underneath there a little bit. But these are the nerves that come out of it. And these are basically from C2, C3, and C4. So you'll see that these nerves kind of ramify in this area here. And so patients that are complaining of pain in this area, it certainly is possible this may be an upper cervical root problem. You also see that there's a nerve that goes up towards the ear off the cervical plexus, and ear pain is a fairly common symptom that patients with neck disorders will complain of, and it certainly is possible that it may be due to irritation of this nerve. And then, of course, you have the brachial plexus, which emerges through the scalenes and then sends multiple nerves down to the arm, which I think Cindy talked about. And this is really important because this is what leads to thoracic outlet syndrome. Now, that's a controversial diagnosis. It's really hard to say to any one person whether it exists or not. But we certainly see a lot of patients that have sort of nondescript neck pain, that have pain in their arm that follows a nerve, that sort of follows a typical nerve territory. And many of those patients may well have a mild thoracic outlet syndrome. Whoops. And this is just posterior. You see some of these branches coming out. These are from the dorsal rami that we discussed before. This little nerve up here is called the greater occipital nerve. Occipital neuralgia is a diagnosis you're throwing around quite a bit. It probably does exist from irritation of the nerve in the muscles where it's, the muscle and fascia where it's emerging. However, any pain that's coming from the upper cervical spine can be referred into that same territory. So I think occipital neuralgia is probably a diagnosis that's overmade a little bit. So when you're doing an examination, it's important to assess motion. The problem with assessing motion in the cervical spine is because it's so complicated, there's multiple things taking place with each movement. So in extension, for example, you have the back of the spine, so the facet joints being loaded, the foramen narrow, and the neck extensors are contracting. So any of these things, if a patient reports pain during movement, it could be really related to any of these things. It's very hard to localize it down to one structure. And similarly with flexion, when you flex, he's not flexed very much, but when you flex, you load the disc, you actually open up the foramen, but then you stretch out all the posterior muscles. So again, reports of pain during movement can be very difficult to interpret. Side bending is sometimes, and rotation are sometimes a little more helpful because you really get a marked reduction in the size of the foramen when the patient is bending to the side. So patients that get reproduction of ipsilateral pain when they're bending to the side, it certainly may be related to some type of foramenal impingement, or this is also loading the facet joints, so that could be an issue. And again, of course, they're also contracting muscles. Now, at the same time you're bending to the side, you're compressing this side, you're stretching the other side. So you can get pain on the contralateral side that can be due to stretch on the nerves or stretch on the muscles, irritated muscles. So again, it can be very difficult to interpret. This is lateral rotation. The same principles apply. Lateral rotation is very similar to lateral bending in terms of what happens inside the spine. So we'll talk about pathology now. This is a classic disc herniation. This is a patient that died during a high-speed motor vehicle accident. And you see the nuclear material here, and it's extruded out, and in this case is creating some pretty severe spinal cord compression. This is pretty uncommon in the cervical spine because by a young age, the discs lose any type of natural definition between the nucleus and the annulus. It becomes just sort of a bunch of fibrocartilage. So it's not quite so common to see these types of what we call soft disc herniations in the cervical spine, but they certainly do occur. This is what it looks like on MRI scan. So here's the disc herniation over here. This is the foramen. And you can sort of see that the disc material sort of looks the same as the material inside here. So that gives you, it's a clue that it's a soft disc herniation rather than an osteophyte, which we'll talk about in a second. So the other pathology that affects the spine very commonly is spondylosis. And this is a sort of a nonspecific term, but it basically just means arthritis of the spine. And it implies that there's a general degeneration in all the structures of the motion segment. So this is a disc here, and these are osteophytes here. These are the dreaded bone spurs that patients get worried about. These are some nerves here that are emerging. And the thing that's really interesting is that this is almost a universal feature of aging, is spondylosis. But you can have severe nerve compression or even spinal cord compression and have absolutely no symptoms whatsoever. So why is that? No one knows for sure. But if it's a gradual process, which most of these things are, obviously, there's probably a few things that happen. One is that the nerve actually atrophies a little bit, so there's more relative room in the foramen for it to be. And the second thing is that the dural sheath sort of toughens up a little bit, gets more fibrotic, and that minimizes pain. So you can have, as I said, severe spondylosis, bone spurs affecting the neural elements, and absolutely no pain whatsoever. In fact, that's probably the majority of cases. At the same time that the discs degenerate, the facet joints do. These are the facet joints on a CT scan. There's a joint there, a joint there, and I think you can see there's advanced osteoarthritis of those joints. And what you get then basically is a spine that looks like this. The discs are narrowed, the end plates are sort of sclerotic, all the joints are degenerated, and the whole thing is basically just arthritic. Now, again, this process is usually painless, but it does create symptoms because as you age and you get spondylotic, you're not as flexible, so you can't move your head around as much as you used to, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be painful. This is what happens with spondylosis in the foramen on CT scan, and you can see that this is a relatively normal facet joint on this side. This is a very arthritic facet joint. And you see this bone spur or osteophyte coming off of the uncinate process. This is classic type of pathology that you see in the cervical spine. So foraminal stenosis here, and pretty much wide open foramen over there. Now, the one thing about spondylosis that's not benign is if it causes cord compression and myelopathy. So this is a patient with some pretty severe cord compression at C4-5. I don't know if you can appreciate it, but there's some edema in the spinal cord. This is what we call the snake eye sign. This whitish stuff is actually edema in the gray matter. So if patients develop cord signal changes like this, that means that their spondylosis, it is not necessarily symptomatic, but it's probably going to be. So this is something that you need to take very seriously if you see these types of changes. Short of that, though, the implications of stenosis are really hard to figure out sometimes. So myelopathy can be a very difficult diagnosis to make. If it's severe and the patient's in a wheelchair, they have a neurogenic bladder or spastic bladder, et cetera, it's obvious. But it's picking up the very early myelopathy that's a little trickier. This is what's called the European myelopathy score that looks just at some different symptoms that occur with myelopathy. Probably the first thing that people will notice is their gait is clumsy, and that's something that you need to check on examination. So that's really important, all patients with any type of cervical pain, to at least at once check their gait. The bladder symptoms, if it's mild myelopathy, they probably won't have much. Sometimes, the bladder and the gait, they're hard to evaluate in older patients because as you get older, your balance gets thrown off and your bladder leaks a little bit, and sometimes it's really hard to know if some of these milder symptoms might be related to myelopathy or not. Handwriting is a big one. If the handwriting is deteriorating, or they're having trouble tying shoelaces, or putting a button in, even with knife and fork, I think you're gonna be pretty bad before that's an issue. Getting dressed and so on, and then obviously pain and paresthesias can also be part of this. So the other thing that's probably the most common diagnosis in the spine is myofascial pain. And how do we diagnose that? We really can't. It's basically a diagnosis of exclusion because the imaging studies don't show anything in the chronic stage. But we do know that injuries to the myofascial structures do happen. These are patients this is a study that did MRI scans on patients 48 hours after a motor vehicle injury. And found a variety of different abnormalities in the soft tissues. This is some edema in the interspinous ligament. This is actually a small epidural hematoma. This is some edema in the anterior longitudinal ligament, or actually there's a little bit of hematoma there. So these, obviously you could imagine how all these things could be painful. This shows an epidural hematoma. And this image here, again from the same study, shows a lot of hematoma in the paraspinal muscles, some edema in the multifidus, some fluid in the facet joint. So all of these things are very common at within the first 48 hours after injury, but no one gets an MRI scan during that time, obviously. But by the time they become chronic, you really don't see these things. And that's a big problem. So we'll go into the clinical evaluation. So as I mentioned, the most important thing with all patients with any type of cervical pain is just make sure they're not, first of all, myelopathic, and second of all, they don't have a radiculopathy. So from terms of myelopathy, it's stuff that you guys learned in the first year of medical school. It's just checking the long track signs, Babinski, make sure they're not hyperreflexic, et cetera. The one thing that sometimes is helpful that you may not be aware of is something called the Hoffman sign. It's a pathologic reflex that's seen in patients with myelopathy. And we'll talk about that in the clinical exam session. Just go back for one second. So again, checking the tandem gait, reflexes, looking for long track signs, checking at least a Hoffman sign, I think is a good screen for myelopathy. And then in terms of radiculopathy, that's sort of the the classic, you know, things, again, we all learned in medical school, looking at the different motor, sensory, and reflex changes that occur with different nerve roots. So the C5 is the deltoid. You want to check deltoid. C5 sensation. There is no reflex for C5. In terms of C6, the biceps is actually sort of C5 and C6. Motor is, where am I there? Motor is wrist extension. You can check the reflex at the brachioradialis and the biceps, and the C6 sensation is in this dermatomal pattern here. C7, triceps is involved. You get sensation abnormalities going down the middle of the arm and into the middle finger. And you get the finger extensors and also the wrist flexors get weak. It's important to note, though, that there's a lot of overlap between these dermatomes. And it's just really relying on sensory abnormalities to decide what level is involved in the neck is not very helpful. So I think it's important to be aware of these. I think when maybe in the case of a stinger, like Cindy was talking about, there may be more classic sort of radicular patterns that are provoked. But when it comes to patients with chronic pain and chronic radiculopathy, these things really go out the window in terms of the sensation. The reflexes and the motor are still important. In fact, the motor is really the most important. C8, sensation is ulnar aspect of the hand and forearm, finger flexors, and the interossei. So that's just sort of a quick whirlwind tour of the radicular signs and symptoms you want to look for. In terms of other important things on the examination, this is the shoulder abduction sign. So if you have a patient that walks into your office, you know, like this, you know for almost for sure they have a cervical radiculopathy, probably due to a disc herniation. Spurling sign everyone is familiar with, head rotated and tilted to the side slightly, and it can produce pain. Classically going into the arm, it's very common when you do this maneuver to get periscapular pain, and for sure neck pain. And it's hard to know what to make of that sometimes. The neck pain is probably not relevant. The periscapular pain may be because some nerve root syndromes will present primarily as periscapular pain rather than arm pain. So the other thing that's really important, so once you've ruled out myelopathy and a serious radiculopathy, and basically with radiculopathy, you really want to make sure their limb is working. We don't really care so much about the sensation or reflexes. So then the next important thing is to try and figure out, well, what exactly is it in the neck that's responsible for the pain? This is a diagram that's been reproduced a lot. I think Cindy actually showed it this morning. This is from a study that was done by injecting the facet joints of asymptomatic volunteers and then looking at the pain patterns that were provoked with those injections. And this is a map that shows basically what kind of pain is provoked with C2-3, goes up in the back of the head, somewhat into the proximal neck. C4-5 goes down a bit lower, C5-6 lower still. And then when you get down around the scapula, it tends to be C6-7. So these are rough guidelines. The thing that's really important about these is that when you get imaging findings back that are grossly discordant with where their pain is, then you know it's important to recognize that that's really not a significant finding. And we'll go through some cases later on that show the importance of that. And again, the other thing that's important to note is that these were obtained in normal volunteers. When you have chronic pain, a lot changes in your brain and your nervous system. You get sensitization, pain patterns, and the whole physiology of how your pain system changes. And so I think that these are very rough guidelines, but certainly are nothing that nothing set in stone about these. So then in terms of the examination, the next thing to do is to check the range of motion. These are normal, so chin to the chest, occiput to the back of the neck is normal, inflection extension. Side bending to either side, it should be about 45 degrees. Rotation, you should be able to get the chin almost to the acromion. What's important about these is not what the range of motion is, it's what happens with the pain when they do it. Because if you have a spondylotic spine, your motions, you're gonna be stiff. But what's really important is what happens to their pain with these different motions. And we'll talk a little bit about how that may be important when we look at the case studies. And finally, palpation. The difficulty with palpation is that if you want to palpate the facet joints, for example, you have to get through a lot of muscles there. And so if you're pressing in this general area, you don't know if you're eliciting pain because of the facet joint or because of the overlying muscles that you're stimulating. It's a little easier to palpate the lateral masses from the side because you're avoiding the trapezius. But the problem with this is that if you press in on the side, you're palpating the lateral mass, you're very close to the foramen. And so you're gonna get some pain probably just from pressing on the foramen where the nerve comes out. So it becomes very difficult to interpret this also. Now, I will say that there are people that can probably identify which segment of the spine is dysfunctional and painful. Those are people that are highly trained in manual medicine. We happen to have one here today, Dr. Mailing up there. So many times a really good manual medicine therapist can figure out, you know, exactly which segment of the spine is dysfunctional, but I certainly can't, and I doubt that most of you will be able to. So now we'll do some case studies. We'll do one on myelopathy, one on radiculopathy, one on mechanical neck pain. This is probably the most common diagnosis that I see. It's a simple diagnosis, just means that your neck hurts when you move it. But it's true mechanical neck pain, there should be a specific movement that triggers it that you can identify reproducibly. Cervicogenic headache we'll talk about. Cervicogenic headache can be difficult. Any neck problem can create tension headaches. So you can have just about anything in your neck that hurts and it can create headaches. But cervicogenic headache is a headache that originates at some structure in the neck and spreads up into the head, elicited by neck movements and other cervical spine maneuvers. And then we'll talk about the cervical brachial syndrome. This is a total wastebasket diagnosis. It just means that, you know, they've got pain, I'm not quite sure where it's coming from. We've ruled out everything else. But it's sort of a nice label to at least to attach to some of these things. So our first case study, this is a 66-year-old woman, extremely active. She line dances, very active in her church. She went to her doctor and he noted an enlarged tonsil on a routine exam. Wasn't cancer. But when they did the neck MRI, they noted spinal stenosis. So this is the neck MRI. And you can probably, maybe you can't appreciate it on the sagittal images, but you can see on the axial images, there's definitely, you know, some bone pressing down on the spinal cord there. So that led to a cervical spine MRI scan, and which showed severe stenosis at C4-5, a little bit lesser stenosis at C5-6. And you see this big osteophyte that's deforming the cord here, and another osteophyte deforming the cord here, a little bit smaller. But still pretty significant. So the question for this lady is, what do we do, if anything? So of course, careful exam. Does she have any evidence of myelopathy at all? If she does, then she goes straight to a surgeon. If she doesn't, what's her prognosis and what kind of treatments should we give her, if any? What kind of precautions? And those are basically all sort of unknown, to be honest. What I tell patients is if they're asymptomatic, I mean, she's had this spine for years, I just go on with my daily business. If she was engaged in action sports, I'd probably tell her to life those, but that's not an issue for most of these people. The other question that comes up is what happens if they're in a car accident and they have some type of low-speed trauma? Is that gonna damage them, make them paralyzed? The answer is probably not, and it's probably not worth it doing a prophylactic decompression of your spine just for that remote possibility. So I tell these patients, you know, continue on with your daily life. One thing, though, is they definitely need to come back for periodic evaluations. So at least once a year, preferably every 6 months or so, someone has to check their gait, their reflexes, make sure they're not developing an early myelopathy. This is a classic type of patient that we see. So it's a 44-year-old stay-at-home mom. She's very fit, regular, vigorous exercise. No prior neck problems whatsoever. She woke up with severe pain, 8/10, going down a lot of pain by the shoulder girdle and scapula, but also going into the arm with numbness and tingling extending down into the middle finger. So she's got no myelopathy. She has some weakness in the triceps and the wrist flexors. So this is all consistent with a C7 radiculopathy. Given her age and acute onset, probably a disc herniation, although you'd be surprised how many patients with spondylotic radiculopathy or radiculopathy due to a bone spur present in a very similar manner. So the key things here are, one is controlling her pain. And the second is assessing her neurologic function. So she does have some weakness in her triceps and wrist flexors. You know, 4/5 is not a reason to panic. If they're 3/5, then you need to send them to a surgeon. But if they're 4/5, more than likely they're gonna recover. So I typically reassure them. I say, you're gonna recover, and don't worry about your weakness, but if it gets worse, you know, come in and see me right away. And then the next thing to do is to manage their pain, and that's what the conservative care is mainly about. So there are a number of things that can be used for this. It really depends on how symptomatic they are. If they're if they're less symptomatic, then you can just use NSAIDs. If they have a red-hot radiculopathy, I'll often use a Metadrol dose pack. There isn't really good evidence to support that, but I do it anyways. And then in the mid range, you sort of have gabapentin, you know, narcotics, if they're really bad, although oftentimes those aren't that helpful. Physical therapy is important. I don't think for an acute disc herniation that chiropractic care is probably a good idea. I think it's excellent for neck symptoms, mechanical neck pain, but I probably would not recommend it for a patient with radiculopathy. And so she failed 6 weeks of conservative care. So at this point, she needs an MRI scan, mainly to determine if there's any other interventions that need to be done, and also to confirm the diagnosis, just make sure we didn't miss something crazy here, like a tumor that's causing C7 nerve root compression. And here's her MRI scan. Here's the paramedian sagittal images. Pretty much normal discs up here. A little bit of disc bulging here and here, totally normal for age. But then if you look at the C6-7 on the left side, you can see that here's the nuclear sort of signal here, which is sort of whitish, and you see it sort of popping out into this little extrusion over here. So this is a soft disc herniation, and it's occupying space in the foramen right here. So this is no doubt causing her pain. Now the good thing about these is the body dissolves these, so you know, probably 70 to 80 to maybe even 90% of patients are gonna recover from this. It just that it hurts like heck while it's healing. But I try to reassure them as much as possible that they're gonna get over it. In this particular case, she did not get over it right away. So we went on and did an epidural steroid injection. This is what's called a transforaminal epidural, where you go in the side of the neck, go right around the foramen where the nerve comes out. And in her particular case, this helped her and she was able to avoid surgery. Now, the data on these is not great. There are definitely risks associated with them. There's case reports of stroke, paralysis, all kinds of nasty stuff. So it's really something that you have to talk over with the patient. I don't think there's any problem at all with proceeding to surgery without this step, although it's sort of become part of the pathway that many people follow. As I mentioned before, the interesting thing is that a patient with spondylotic radiculopathy or radiculopathy due to a bone spur in the foramen can present in virtually the same way, and they can have the same course. In fact, they usually do. So they usually do get better. They usually don't require surgery. And it's sort of the same type of treatments that you apply to both. So what happens if the conservative care doesn't work? Then the options are surgery. There's a couple different ways that can be done. One is to just go through the back and sort of scrape out the offending area. In the spine, that works if it's more lateral. If they have to go too medial, then they get into, they can't do it because the spinal cord's in the way. This is what it looks like when it's done via a minimal invasive approach. It's called a keyhole foraminotomy. It's just a little tiny channel drilled in the bone there, and that's what it looks like on a reformatted image. So it's just a little hole there, and I think this is a perfectly fine way to go. If it was me and I had that option, I would go with that for surgery rather than a spinal fusion. Now the problem with this is that sometimes you can't get to the pathology, and only the surgeon can decide for sure if they can do that, If it's foraminal, they usually can. The other problem is that they're more prone to relapses because you are weakening, you're going and you're sort of scraping out there, and they can be more prone to relapses. You haven't fixed the motion problem. The bone spurs occur because of excess motion, and that's why the bone spur occurs, and they're still moving, and so they can reform the bone spurs and need more surgery. So the other option is to do a spinal fusion. What they do with this is they go in from the front and they clean out the area the same way they do going from the back, essentially, except they can get at areas where they were obstructed by the spinal cord going in the back. And so you clean out that whole disc, take out all that stuff, and then put in a piece of bone graft in there to hold it all together. So, and that's sort of the classic approach, I would say, until recently. Foraminotomies were very popular, in mid last century. Then people got into doing anterior cervical discectomy infusions. And more recently, the pendulum has shifted a little bit back towards the foraminotomy. But this is what a fusion looks like. Usually they put a plate in there to hold it all together. And this probably gives a more reliable result from the initial surgery, but it places stress on the bones adjacent to it and on the discs and all the other structures, and they get what's called adjacent segment disease. And that's what this turns into. So here this patient has a spinal fusion here, two levels. And then you see the level above, there's a lot of stenosis from degeneration at that segment. And the level below, same thing, a lot of stenosis. So then you're back in doing another fusion. And one thing oftentimes leads to another. And next thing you know, you've got this poor lady who's actually at this point is fused from C2 to the sacrum, believe it or not. Guess what? Still has pain. So that's an argument against fusions. So at the other end of the spectrum is the cervical brachial syndrome, which, as I said, is just a vague diagnosis. Patients that have a lot of neck pain, they also have pain going down into the arm, can follow radicular territory. They frequently have pain in other areas, so they sort of overlap into the fibromyalgia category that Dr. Gross was talking about this morning. And the pain is more than, this is the imaging studies, don't show much of anything, some sort of age-related changes, no nerve root compression. So these patients are just really difficult to manage because there's not a whole lot you can do. It's basically managing their anxiety, reassurance, trying to keep them off narcotics, away from procedures. And it's probably due to some combination of myofascial pain, probably an elevated pain sensitivity. I think that's a real big issue that we don't pay enough attention to. There may be some thoracic outlet irritation that's causing the arm symptoms. But the important thing here is just to make sure that we've ruled out any other significant problems, such as, let's describe what that is again. Don't make sure they're not radiculopathic. They don't have shoulder and rotator cuff pathology. Sometimes shoulder pathology can present with distal symptoms. Ruling out peripheral entrapment neuropathies is very important. Parsons-Turner syndrome, Dr. Allen talked about this morning. And again, it's probably due to some combination of myofascial pain, thoracic outlet syndrome, and elevated pain sensitivity. So we're going to get into mechanical neck pain now. This is a patient, 76-year-old gentleman, very healthy and active. He has sort of a chronic stiff neck, which you'd expect for a 76-year-old guy. But 4 months ago, he developed this severe left-sided neck pain, and it's sort of localized right in that mid-cervical region. Really painful. It does not go up into his head, doesn't go down to the shoulder. It's really sort of localized right there, reliably aggravated by turning his head to the left. So it suggests it's either facet joint problem, perhaps radiculopathy, although that would be very unusual without at least some radiation to the shoulder. You can occasionally get patients with a C3 or C4 radiculopathy that can present with neck pain only, but that's very uncommon. So more than likely, there's some type of a facet joint irritation or perhaps some localized muscle irritation. So he goes through the normal physical therapy, NSAIDs, he's no better. This is what his MRI scan looks like. You see advanced multilevel spondylosis, some pretty severe spinal cord compression at multiple levels. And you see the same thing on his axial images. Here's a spinal cord squashed there, squashed here, squashed there. That one's not so bad, a little bit of CSF there. But he's got severe multilevel spinal cord compression. But he has absolutely no radicular symptoms and no myelopathy. So what's the source of his pain? So one thing that I think is really important to look for in these patients, and I look for it routinely, is look at what's happening to the facet joints. And in particular, what's happening with what we call the T2-weighted images, which are most sensitive for inflammation. And you see at this level here, there's an effusion in the joint, and you see a lot of subchondral bone edema, and this actually correlates very nicely with the location of his pain. Now, the problem with this is that you know some radiologists are clued into this, many are not, so it sort of depends upon the person in your area. If you have access to someone other than radiologists who can do a clinical evaluation and also read the MRI scan, that can be very helpful. But I think it's very important to be aware of this particular problem because I think it's huge. And in fact, I think these are the kinds of problems that we can treat pretty reliably. In this particular case, he had an injection of corticosteroid into the joint, and his pain went away. He's come back, I think I saw him a few years ago, he's come back once or twice since then for a touch-up, but basically he's pretty happy, and there's really no other surgery that can be done for him. So I think this is a really important illustration of how you really have to match the symptoms to the imaging, and just because you see horrible stenosis and horrible this and horrible that doesn't mean it's symptomatic at all. This is a very similar patient. This is an elderly woman. This is the open mouth view of the odontoid. You see the lanofacial joint on the right is wide open. On the left is very arthritic. So this is a really classic presentation. These patients come in with severe pain localized in the upper cervical region over the lateral aspect, and it's reliably aggravated by turning their head. So if they rotate their head, that's the movement that twists the lanofacial joint, and they get pain there and they're arthritic, then that's almost certainly the cause of pain. And that can be managed oftentimes with corticosteroids. It doesn't cure it, but if you can get by with one or maybe two a year, that's sort of a reasonable way to go. The only other option is to fuse them, and that's a fairly big procedure with no guarantee of success. We'll skip over that. So this is a 46-year-old anesthesiologist, another mechanical neck pain patient, very healthy, active, swims. He was up sledding at Mount Rose with his kids, slammed into a tree. He developed this pain over here on the left side of his neck, I'm sorry, the right side of his neck, very localized. He's been through all kinds of treatment. He's powers through work, but he can't do anything else. And again, his pain, it's very localized, and it's aggravated by rotation and by extension. So again, that leads us to some type of posterior problem, either a facet joint or perhaps a muscle. Here's what his MRI scan looks like. It's pretty unremarkable. A little bit of disc bulging here, disc narrowing, totally normal for age. His facet joint at C3-4, though, is arthritic. And again, we see this. I can't see the screen from here, but we see the, up here. So we see the inflammatory changes in the joint at C3-4. So he went through a facet joint injection, didn't help him. So he went on to a procedure called the facet rhizotomy, which we sometimes will do for patients with pain that we really think is coming from the facet joints. This is done under CT, but it's usually done under X-ray. And basically he's putting an insulated needle on the edge of the lateral mass where the nerve that goes to the facet joint runs. It comes out here and runs back here. So you put it on here and you cauterize the nerve, basically. And that, in the right patient, can be very helpful. Can lead to a year or more of pain relief and can be repeated. This particular case, his pain went completely away after the rhizotomy and hasn't come back. That was probably 5 or 6 years ago. That's unusual. I think I might, I'm losing track of my time. Okay, so let me do this one real quick and then we'll skip the rest of them and go to the exam. So this is a really interesting patient. She's sort of a hard-charging CFO type. She goes around the world with her husband shooting. She actually shoots rhinoceros with a handgun. So she's totally crazy. She had a freak injury while she was duck hunting. Her husband shot a duck. The duck fell out of the sky. It hit her on the side of the head, dislocated her jaw. And now she's got this pain here. So left side of her neck. So it's pretty well localized, but the thing that's different here is in opposed to those other patients, is that she also has this numbness and tingling down around the shoulder. So it sort of makes you worry a little bit, could this be more of a radicular syndrome than a purely mechanical pain type syndrome? I think this was something that I think a couple of people alluded to this morning. When you have shoulder symptoms, you do have to think about the neck, particularly if it's posterior. If it's anterior shoulder pain, it's usually not the neck. But if it's posterior shoulder pain, it certainly can be, particularly if it's radiating from the neck, obviously. But even isolated symptoms can sometimes be coming from the cervical spine. In her case, she was actually referred by a surgeon who saw some stenosis at the C4-5 level. It's not a lot, but there's some. And he was planning to operate. He requested a nerve root injection, which is sort of like that epidural I showed before. We just put a little cortisone around that nerve, and if they get better, that sort of confirms the diagnosis. But she didn't get better with the cortisone. And then in a closer look at her MRI scan, she again had this fusion, some little bit of edema, and she ended up having a facet joint injection, and her pain went away, including the numbness and tingling. So numbness and tingling can sometimes be neurologic, but it can also be sort of a nondescript sensory symptom that can be due to other factors. In this case, it could also be due to just inflammatory radiculitis, because the nerve lives right next to the facet joint. It's certainly possible that could have been playing a role. So I've got some others, but I think we better do the exam, right? Okay.